Hello everyone again. So my presentation is really about basics of FIA, and it's a widget. And I would like to start with Dima, so we see what kind of widgets we have in FIA and why it's important to understand their life cycles. So when you open FIA first time, you see what we call application shell, which consists of this main area where we can open some editors. We have sidebars, bottom panel, menu, and so on. And so application shell itself is actually a widget, which is composed of many widgets. And then you can open new widgets in the shell, like in different areas of different kind. For example, we have views, like Explorer. So what's special about views is they are singletons. So you can open Explorer or Git view. Well, it's same now, same view. And then we have additional to views, widgets which you can have multiple instances, like terminals. So I have two terminals here. And then I can open multiple editors. And then, it's a new feature. When I double click. So yesterday somebody asked if they could use zoom in. Now you can zoom in with double click. It's a new feature. And for files, for example, you can also register different kinds of these widgets which have multiple instances. So we have preview here. And then also there are a lot of contracts based on widgets. For example, some widgets are savable. So when I change something, shell knows that it's become dirty, and then you can save it. Or some widgets we call navigatable. It means that they backup by some URIs. And for example, when you switch to from one editor to another, you see that in navigator get revealed based on this contract. Or let's say you rename the file, and then shell knows that it has to also rename corresponding editors and previews and so on. So I can also rename, for example, changelog. And it renames both previews and editors. So I hope you see that shell widget is basic concept of FIA, and you can do a lot with that. My presentation more focused on really basic contracts, not with contracts where you compose different widgets. So what is a widget in FIA? Basically, it's just an HTML element with lifecycle hooks. It kind of comes from Phosphor, but we also, I think we like it because then we can integrate any framework for rendering. So we can take React and render something in HTML element. We can take Angular. I'm not sure why you will do it in practice to combine different frameworks. But generally for FIA, we can migrate from one framework to another. So if React replaces jQuery or something replaces React in the future, it's not a problem for us to move on. So here is a declaration of very basic widget. In FIA, we have this class-based widget. So you can look at subclasses to see all kinds of widgets which what we have. And then there are some basic properties, like you define a label of widget, which is you see the name title. You can provide a tooltip, icon which you want to have, and you say whether my widget closable or not. So then if you have this X, that you can close it. And in FIA we use dependency injection, as you know, to wire everything together, and we don't do kind of exceptions for some components. So all widgets are also injectable. So extenders can override them and change how everything looks like. Even application shell is injectable. So you have to add this injectable annotation for your widget, and then you can start injecting some services or inject your widget somewhere else. Okay, so then how do we have a widget, how we now get an instance? Usually you get instance from dependency injection, but widgets are very special because FIA should know about them and know what kind of the identity to. For example, when you reload, let's do it. Let's go back to Dima. And so when I reload the page, You know, the whole layout is preserved is because Fia knows what kind of widgets and with which information they should be initialized. So because of that, we have the concept which calls a widget manager. And whenever you want to get an instance of widget, you should ask it to create. From implementation side, so when you provide a new widget, you bind it. And then you have this widget factory. You have this widget factory which is picked up by widget manager for factory ID. And you provide some options which uniquely identify all these widgets for the same factory. So basically, the contract is that widget ID is factory ID plus widget options, which you pass. And now I want to look at just a couple examples to give you a feeling how these widget ID are created. So the first one, which I said, is with Singleton views. And in Fia, we already have a base contribution point with abstract view contribution, which you have to extend. And in that case, you just provide factory ID and widget options are empty. So widget manager will just use this factory and create or give you the same widget for the same ID. Okay, and then you can provide some additional options like where it should appear by default, what is the name, and what command and key bindings you should use to toggle it. The second use case, as I said, is with multiple widgets for URIs, for example. So we could have code editor and preview. And Fia again provides you some basic contribution point. It's called widget open handler. And the contract is that you have two methods, can handle and open. Can handle basically say whether I can open this URI or not for given options. And then if it says like give a number, priority, because we need to sort and show them in some order. Later Fia call open actually to open the widget. And here, factory ID is an ID of your open handler. And then options are URIs. So it's, factory ID plus array. You get other options here, but they are not the same which is used by widget manager with options to reveal something inside your widget. So let's say editor selection or whether it should be, editor should be open in preview mode. If you put it inside widget options, then for each selection you will get a new editor for the same URI. It's not what you want. Okay. So the next thing when you get an instance, you should somehow attach it to the DOM that the user can see it. And yeah, as I mentioned during the demo, we have these four areas and you can attach to one of them. And for that you use application shell. It's this class which in prepresent shell. And it has a method add widget where you provide a widget and area where you want to show it. And yeah, to remove it, just use this static method widget detach, which will detach it from shell. So these options are a bit more flexible. You can do more than just opening them in some area. For example, here we have an editor, and when we want to open to preview for it in main area, but split it to right relative to this widget, to this editor. So what you will have, basically get a new, you add preview here to the right. And there are more options like you can split down or next before or after in different areas. And so it's quite flexible, this attachment. Then the next thing when you have it in DOM, shell will try to activate it. Activation basically means focusing it. And here you need to know about couple concepts. First concept is from DOM API. It's called active document element. So here, for example, text area inside editor is focused, and on document you find active element which you point to it. So it's the only one element can be focused. And then there's an active widget. It's among widgets which are known to shell. It's one which contains this active document element. The second concept is a current widget. It's the last active widget. So in this case, it's the same because we have something focused. But then we, for example, let's look at this example. So what do you think is active and current widget? Any guess? It's tricky, but it's a very typical situation with commands, because this menu panel, it's not tracked by shell, so there is no active widget, because some widget which is not known to shell have focus. But there is still current widget pointing to last focus. So this command usually should implement basic on the current widget. So it's one thing about activation. And then, so on widget API, we have these callbacks which start with on, like on activate request, on attach, detach, show, render, update, and so on. And there's an important contract to activate. You have to focus something. If you don't focus, shell does not know that your editor is current or active. And commands which you see in the context menu, they would be the for previous widget. So you shouldn't forget. You will find these warnings in terminal, obviously, if you forget about it. Okay. So it's how you programmatically activate the widget. On shell, you just call activate widget, and you pass ID of your widget, which should be unique among all widgets known to shell. And then there are some questions sometimes. I don't want to really focus something, but I want to show something to user, some widget. So this is another method, reveal widget. It won't give a focus. It will just bring it to visible in shell. OK, so you focus now in now most interesting part, where you actually render something. It's maybe not important, but generally, but in fear, we use this unidirectional data flow. And idea that we have is extract state, which we update. And then view just kind of patch the DOM with difference against the state. So I have example now. So for example, I have such service which has some value, and it fire a did change event whenever value is changed. So when I assign hello world, it emits this event. And then to schedule re-rendering of the widget, you call update method on it. It will post event into browser event view, which eventually will trigger with on update request on your widget, where you should implement rendering. And so here we basically, like with DOM, we compare whether values are different, and we just patch the DOM use a difference. And so this approach simplifies a lot writing views, because you don't need to think about logic. You just compare against the state, and you apply patches to DOM. And we use React, so it's a bit different. There is a base React widget, but the idea again is the same. We have service, and we just render input element, and we provide a value. So in this case, we don't do comparison, because React will create this model and compare against the previous and just do updating. But that is some pitfalls with React, so you have to go through tutorials. So to make it performant, you have to know a bit. I won't go in details, because it's really a big topic and on. And so when you render something, now you actually want to process inputs from user, like handle events. And on widget, we have another callback on after attach, where you can provide install listeners for different DOM elements. It's like here we install for this for input. When it's changed, we update the service value. So this add event listener comes from superclass. You also can do it on input itself, but the problem is that you have to destroy all listeners when you detach the widget. And if you use this method, it makes it for you. If you install it yourself, it's your responsibility to collect them and so on. So it's just shortcut, let's say. With React, it's a bit different. I won't show it right now. The last thing, we want to destroy our widget. So to destroy, you just call dispose method. And usually what you see in the presentation, we use so-called disposable collection and just call dispose on it. Why it's useful? So let's have a look here. Yeah, first, don't forget, if you forget some listener which will keep global status and something we are leaking and so on, so you don't forget collect listeners and services which bound to a widget and so on. And you could also don't use this post collection, but iterate yourself and call this post method. The problem is that whenever some throw exception, it destroys this dispose sequence, and consequently other disposable objects won't be destroyed. In dispose collection, take care about exception and so on. So it will make sure that everything is disposed properly. Okay. It was most commonly used callbacks like how you create, activate, render, and so on. But there are others on widgets. So for example, the to hide and show, it's basically on widget there's this method hide show which toggle display CSS property of the widget. And then it also fire with event that you can do something. I personally never done anything with that. Then callbacks, they need it only if you implement custom layout. I think I use it only once before with view containers, which we have. But for usual widgets, you don't need it. On close request, by default, it just called dispose. So mostly you can just add something to dispose of your collection what you want to do and don't care. But maybe in some cases, you want to do something else on closing of the widget. And on resize also interesting. So what happens when you resize, for example, sidebars in shell, then it will recalculate sizes for all child widgets and pass this on resize request. And then you can resize your content inside the widget. So we use it for terminals and editors to resize them. Okay. Yeah, I think it was it. Yeah, awesome. A bit short presentation. Okay, so if you have some questions about widgets and so on. Okay.
Do you have an example of a minimal widget? What is the minimal needed to make a widget?
I think it's at the beginning it was like really. So it's a declaration. Yeah. Wait. Yeah, so with declaration and then you, to instantiate it, you provide this code. So you bind to the widget and then you provide widget factory. And then anybody can create it. But it's minimal in the sense that it doesn't render anything. then you still have to update, implement an update request and draw something in your node. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have, so for FIA workshop, we have some tutorials on building JSON forms. It's on GitHub, I think, if you're interested. I can show you. Type fox, something like FIA workshop. It has example also with React and so on, and it's progressive, so it starts small with very simple widget and then some open handlers, React, and then really complex thick in the end. So maybe you also can do this one. I haven't updated for 1 year, so I'm not sure how good it runs. Okay, that's it. Other questions?
So we are also using widgets in Embed Studio. So what we were was showing also for the Perion device management connectivity, it's a widget. What we like about it is just the possibility of moving the widgets around, like in different places. And one of the callback you mentioned about on resize is also very useful when you are moving the widget in different locations, so either on the left or on mm-hmm. the bottom. You can have the slightly different layout depending on where the widget is located, which is very, very useful.
Okay, so not a question, but good. Thanks.
I think the debugger actually uses that when you kind of, changes to
horizontal
we use it. Layout.
I think Anatoly did it, that we relay out it horizontally and vertically depending where it is. It's actually what we need also for view containers because we can drag and drop them. And then what they do in debug view as well, the same right now. So you can, so they don't stack vertically but horizontally isn't a problem.
some time to implement it. No, I already have an idea.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, we still have time.
So there's a couple of different abstract sort of like classes you can inherit from to create your widgets mm-hmm. that give you different features and functionality. Is there a way of combining them together? So if you wanted features from both abstract classes.
Yeah, what kind of features you mean?
I don't have any specific examples. I know you had a base widget, which is probably the base of everything.
Yeah, it's
but I'm just wondering if you have perhaps something that needs to be a multiple sort of like editor window, but also
you mean the compose widget?
Yeah, can you compose the base features basically?
You can create a new widget, and then create a child widget and add them to layout. So it's kind of for example, for debug views, we do it so with variables and so on. Each of them is its own widget, and then this is common widget where we put it through layouting. But the thing is, these widgets, they are not there's different kinds. They don't belong to application shells. So they don't have the same contract. Yeah. Another example may be preferences. So here we really embed editors inside preference view. So and there are more complex contracts. I don't know how it's called, but you basically implement an interface for parent widget, and it exposes additional widgets which should be tracked by shell as well. So with preference. We should do it. Yeah.
Thank you. Are those these widgets and the way you build them documented?
No. No. Not really.
Not yet.
Not yet. Yeah. This code is kind of documentation.
How can you do dialogues or wizards?
There are also widgets, and we have. A super class which is called is a dialog TS. There is abstract dialog class which you have to subclass and it would be a new dialog. And so it's a bit different than you don't need to use widget manager. You just create an instance and you call open method on it. And it will show. So for example, when you do digit from Gitpod. It will open a dialog. Okay. Yeah, maybe we have to document all these base classes that people have easy time to finding what they want to achieve. Yeah.
Those are also good candidates for public APIs.
Public APIs. I think they are already, and we probably won't change them. Yeah.
You said that the widget can be savable, right?
Right, it's this savable interface, and basically you can make anything savable.
But if it is savable, then it is integrated with the autosave configuration?
Yeah, so everything is integrated with the same autosave. If you do savable, everything behaves the same.
Okay.
We don't have different preferences for different kinds of widgets.
It was always like that, or was
it
changed?
We decided for it, and we didn't question it so far. So
okay.
Is there a way to detach a widget?
Yeah. You mean programmatically or just?
Yeah.
When I click with close button, it's detached.
Oh, okay. So detach, get a new browser window that I can put on another monitor, for instance.
Not yet, but I think maybe. Someone can comment on it. You know. We have plans, yes, something like that. So you can extract basically a widget to another window, but it works for the same workspace.
Yeah. So a multi-window layout. What you can do is open multiple front ends on the same back end, but then they don't know each other. So. It's useful, for instance, if you want to have a terminal on a different monitor, you can do that. It's fine. There are no mm-hmm. big issues with that. But I think in many other cases, we would need to have some sort of communication channel between the windows to communicate with each other. And we don't have that yet. Yeah.
Yep.
But it's not the first time that was asked. So.
Okay. So if nobody have questions, maybe we can have a break. Okay, thank you.